Good morning and welcome to our online broadcast. It is January 29th. It is Stony Creek Baptist Church, and we welcome you in the name of the Lord. So let's just take a moment to pray, and please, as we do, if you would remember Marty and Sheldon and Nicole as they continue on in their journeys, that God would really have his hand upon them and encourage and bless them, and many, many others that are struggling in our congregation, both online and on campus in Stony Creek. We just need to be aware, to the best of our abilities, to pray for one another, to lift one another up before the throne of grace, and even in a general sense, just to lift up the whole concept of people struggling and people needing special prayer. So let's do that this morning. Also, I want to remember before we start that Bible study does start February 7th. I believe that's a Tuesday, February 7th at 7 p.m. By Zoom, the way we did it last year. And we look forward to that. So if you'd like to join in, please make sure that we have your email address so we can send that out to you so that you can connect and join in our Bible study, which starts February 7th. That's Tuesday at 7 p.m. So let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day that you've given us. We thank you for your grace. And Father, we just pray for those individuals, especially that we've mentioned this morning, for Sheldon, for Marty, for Nicole, and for so many others, Father, that just need that special touch from you. Father, you know our needs, you know our hearts, you know us better than we know ourselves. And so, Father, we commit in our walk of faith to you to be with us in a special way as our good shepherd, to lead us, to encourage us, to strengthen us, and to bless us. And especially be with those folks that need that special touch in a medical sense for their health. And Father, be with them, I pray. Father, be with us as a church family too. Watch over my ministry, my family. Father, just strengthen them, I pray. And be with us in a special way as we continue on to hold out the word of life, to preach scriptural truth, to preach the good news of Jesus Christ. Just be with us in a special way as a pastor, as a congregation and church, both online and on campus in Stony Creek. So, Father, be with us now. May we worship you in spirit and truth, for we ask these mercies in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. I'm reading from 2 Corinthians 4, 16 to 18, and I'm reading from the New Revised Standard Version this morning. So we do not lose heart, Paul says, even though our outer nature is wasting away, our inner nature is being renewed day by day. For this slight and momentary affliction is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all measure. Because we look not at what can be seen, but at what cannot be seen. For what can be seen is temporary, Paul says, but what cannot be seen is eternal. May God bless to our understanding this, the reading of his word. After worship one Sunday, a little boy told his pastor, he was at the back and he looks up at his pastor, he says, "When I grow up, I'm going to give you some money." "Well, thank you," the pastor replied. "But why? Why would you want to give me some money?" "Because my daddy says you're one of the poorest preachers we've ever heard." Well, I use that this morning to open up in a small way because Paul, and we see in 2 Corinthians here as we read through the whole book, we see that Paul is criticized for his oratory skills. He was deemed a good writer, but not such a good preacher. So anyway, I don't know if anybody ever gave him a little extra money because of that, but whatever. But that was a cute little kid. I'd like to share this morning a very brief look into the life of the Apostle Paul. I've entitled this message, Living by Faith. When things boil right down to the bottom denominator, the basic principles of our lives as believers, that's what we're doing this morning as followers of Christ, simply living by faith, walking with Jesus. No matter what situation we find ourselves in, we are all striving, all of us, day by day, to walk by faith, to walk with Jesus. There is no more interesting place than 2 Corinthians to look to examine Paul's life of faith and to get an intimate picture of who Paul really was. Get a look into his person. Why do I say this? Well, let me share some small quotes here, very small. This first person says, "Few portions of the New Testament pose as many problems for translators and interpreters as 2 Corinthians. Few, therefore, are the preachers who undertake a systematic exposition of its contents. For those undaunted by its demands, however, and this is what I want us to focus on, an intimate picture of a pastor's heart may be found as the Apostle Paul shepherds the wayward Corinthians and revealed a love which comes only from God. This commentator goes on to say, no letter of Paul is more personal and intimate in nature than 2 Corinthians. In it, he bared his soul and professed his abiding love for the Corinthians despite of the apparent fickleness of their affection for him. Another commentator writes, this book, more than any other letter of Paul, shows us the heart and mind of the apostle to the Gentiles. It is the closest we have to his spiritual, pastoral autobiography. The writer goes on to say, this book is a strange combination, like Paul himself, of spiritual highs and lows, of free-flowing emotions ranging from anger to great joy. It's like peeling those layers of something apart, a fruit or a vegetable. We get to see the real thing, the real Paul. 2 Corinthians peels back those layers and exposes us to the real Apostle Paul. Why am I saying this? To get a feel for Paul's walk of faith you must get a feel for his basic emotions. I call them gut level emotions as a believer, as an apostle, as a pastor, his highs and lows, his joys and his challenges. And we do that by the big picture, the highs and lows, as he writes to the church in Corinth, as he opens himself up to his readers by inspiration. And human personality, it's so neat when we look at Scripture. I find it so fascinating and so interesting how the Lord, how God uses our personalities, the personalities of people, all different, all unique, to get his message, his perfect, complete, inspired message across through these human writers. And he certainly does that in 2 Corinthians through the Apostle Paul. My goal this morning is to encourage you and I as we walk with Jesus. From Paul's personal journey, there are some important things, just three little things in these verses, these three verses of Scripture, but are so important, I think, as we strive to walk with Jesus, as Paul did, as we walk by faith. The first one is, we've got to hang on to the big picture. We've got to hang on to the big picture. In these verses, Paul compares the outer man and the inner man. If you read this book, you will see him literally recall being beaten up for Christ. You will see him suffering from physical ailments. You will see him literally, as you follow the chronological order of his life, literally run out of town, and the people that he devoted his life to and heart are now departing from him, are buying into the false lies about his pastoral and apostolic ministry. But, and I say a big but, Paul focuses not on that. He's touched by it. Obviously, he's disturbed by it. He's hurt by it. We see the emotional Paul. But his focus is on the inner man, Christ in us, as he says, the hope of glory. That inner flame, that inner life, the resurrected Christ that lives in us. And by that, he looks forward to the day when faith will become sight. Until that day, we live by faith, by trust, by assurance that the living Christ who indwells us, who indwells you and me, will never, never let us go. Galatians 2:20, quoted that many times lately, and it's no wonder Martin Luther got up every day and in his daily devotions as he started the day, quoted this verse every day of his life. I have been crucified with Christ. In other words, I have, because of trusting in Jesus Christ, I positionally gain the riches of Christ, the merit of the cross and his resurrection, etc. So I have been crucified. I am positionally in Jesus Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me, in you and me. And the life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God. We walk by faith daily in these bodies, by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I like the way the New Living Translation puts it. My old self has been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And so I live in this earthly body by trusting in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Interestingly, note here that he opens this chapter with the words, "Therefore, since through God's mercy, we have this ministry, we do not lose heart." We do not lose heart. Connecting us to verse 16, where he says, so what? So exactly the same, we do not lose heart. I like the way one translator puts it. He says, we're not giving up. How could we? How could we? My friends, hang in. Jesus is with you. Hear that again. He is with you, and his love and sovereign grace will never, never, as I have said, let us go. Secondly, we've got to hang on to our glorious hope. We've got to hang on to the big picture. We've got to hang on, secondly, to our glorious hope. Biblical hope is the confident expectation of what God has promised, and its strength is in his faithfulness. And its strength is in his faithfulness. So it is based on the eternal plan God has for you and I, and it's based on God bringing that to ultimate completion and fulfillment, not only now, day by day, but throughout eternity. It is founded in God's love in Christ for us. It is empowered in God's love in Christ for us, and it will never change. It will encompass us, you and me, forever. Listen again, my friends, listen again to Paul's words. So we do not lose heart. Even though our outer nature is wasting away, our inner nature is being renewed day by day. For this slight momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all measure, because we look not at what can be seen, but at what cannot be seen. And what can be seen is temporary, but what cannot be seen, my friends, Paul says, is eternal. Well, what is going on in Paul's life as he writes this? Well, he's got the effects of natural aging, the effects of physical punishment that he has endured by sharing the good news of Jesus Christ. He has his thorn in the flesh, his criticism, again, as I have said in that little joke, they said he's a good writer, but not such a good preacher. Attacks on his apostolic calling and office, attacks on his integrity as a pastor, plus the constant concern, Paul says, for the church, the churches, the pressure of guiding and watching over them and keeping them pure, away from doctrine that is erroneous, and keeping them on the track, as we would say, with sound biblical doctrine today. These all were weighing on him. But in light of this, it is ultimately the hope that he had in the resurrected Jesus Christ and the empowerment of the resurrection, both now and throughout eternity, that he focused on in his walk of faith that we need to focus on in our walk of faith. What are these things that we call hope? Well, hope is instilled by the resurrection. It's the foundation. And throughout these passages in 2 Corinthians, we see that. And actually, when you take out the doctrine of the resurrection and of the New Testament, it completely collapses. It makes no sense. The resurrection holds together the writings and theology, the hope that we have in the New Testament. Hope of his calling and God's providence going before him, in the message and empowerment of the resurrection, touching lives for Jesus Christ. Lives were being changed. And it's a wonderful hope that we have, because we know of the reality of Jesus Christ, that Christ in us, the hope of glory, that we are those new creations in Jesus Christ by the power of the crucified Christ and the resurrected Christ in our lives. Hope in the friends and colleagues, the brothers and sisters in Christ who stood with him in life and in ministry. The hope of the coming of Jesus Christ, the imminent coming, the rapture, are catching away of the church. The hope in eternity and the joy that awaits us both physically and spiritually, one in the same package, but in all ways encompassing us. As C.S. Lewis says, the joy of heaven, the hope of heaven, it will be incredible. Hope, joy is the language of heaven. Hope is marked by the sealing of the Holy Spirit. We are sealed until the day of redemption as a guarantee, as a protection, as a security. We have that hope because of Jesus' death and resurrection and the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit. And this is for all, I mean all believers, followers of Christ. And hope in the ministry and office, his apostolic office he was called to, and how it was fulfilling God's will, laying that foundation of the church as people responded to the good news of Jesus Christ throughout North Africa, the Mediterranean basin, throughout Asia Minor, for all over the place. God was at work, and he is at work, my brothers and sisters, today. I read this one person, I want to share this with you. He sums it up well. He says, therefore, biblical hope is a reality and not a feeling. Let me read that again. Therefore, biblical hope is a reality and not a feeling. Biblical hope carries no doubt. Biblical hope is a sure foundation upon which we base our lives, believing that God always keeps his promises. Accepting that gift of eternal life means our hope is no longer filled with doubt, but rather has at its sure foundation the whole of God's word, the entirety of God's character, and the finished work of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Well put, my friend, and I say amen. Now faith, the writer to the Hebrews writes so eloquently. Now, faith is the confidence in what we hope for and the assurance about what we do not see. Hope, think of it in these terms, my friends. Hope is the mortar that holds the bricks of faith together. Hope is the mortar that holds the bricks of faith in your life, in my life, together. And lastly, my friends, this morning, as we take this from Paul, we've got to hold on to our calling. We have to hold on to our calling. A good part of 2 Corinthians, and as we break this book down, we see that 2:14 to 6:10 and 10:1 to 12:18 and elsewhere in this book, focus on Paul's calling, his apostolic calling in defense of that. He defends personally and literally his conduct in ministry in light of the attacks on him. So calling and the fulfillment of that calling are a large part of this letter. But it is important as we context that, as we get that big picture, as we focus on that, it is important that as we reflect on that, we remember that we too, you and I, are called. As believers, as children of God, we all have been called by the Lord to live for him in the situations we find ourselves in. God in his sovereignty, scripture tells us, has placed his hand upon each one of us and called us, you and me, to be ambassadors for him. 2 Corinthians 5:20 actually states, we are therefore Christ's ambassadors. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors. This used to be the most beloved section of scripture from my great prof, Reverend Dr. Andrew McCrae, the principal and dean of Acadia, and I was his teaching assistant, got to know him well. He was my professor of evangelism. What a godly man, now with the Lord. This was his favorite passage. As we walk by faith, we walk in confidence. Listen, we walk in confidence, like Paul says here, that we make a difference to those around us through the opportunities that are presented to us, through our personalities, our life experiences, our gifts and talents, our resources, our time, our struggles and failures, and the witness we have in and through them, because we all have them. Even Paul had them. Many of us are limited by our situations. In fact, we all have. When you stop and think about it, we all have limitations as to what we would ideally like to do. And so did Paul. And that is okay. What we need to do is focus on is what we can do to make a difference, not what we cannot do. What we can do to make a difference, not what we cannot do. We can pray, we can encourage, we can worship, we can praise, we can reach out in our unique situations to be what? Ambassadors for Christ. Remember, as we face each new day with Christ, we are a team. You are an important part of God's story that He is writing in this place, in this day, in this age. In faith, commit yourself. Commit yourself like Paul. Remember how much time, I was thinking about this week. Paul spent a great deal of his adult life where? In prison, in jail. Did he sit back and say, oh me, oh my, what can I do? No, he took the bull by the horns, and look at what he did while he was in prison. Look for the opportunities. Let us pray for one another. Let us serve one another as He works through us. Listen, I know there might be somebody listening this morning that might think they are not making a difference. But listen, my friend, do not, or my friends, do not listen to that voice. It is wrong. It is wrong. You are making a big difference to God, to me, and to the situations you find yourself in. You, my friends, are, as I have said, difference makers. Believe me, you are. And I thank God for each one of you. May Paul's walk of faith empower your walk of faith and my walk of faith as we think about these things in closing. The big picture. Remember the big picture. We know that the final chapter has not been written. As we face our challenges and struggles, which we all do, we know that God is in control, and we have to focus on the big picture now of God's daily presence with us, and by faith trust each day to Him, and the future to His glorious plans for you and I. The big picture. Our hope. Through the death and resurrection of Jesus, we have that sure foundation that gives us hope, the ongoing assurance that can encourage us daily and throughout eternity. As the old hymn that we sang last week, faith is the victory. Faith is the victory, what? That overcomes the world. And finally this morning, our calling. By faith each day, we serve in whatever capacity we can as ambassadors for Christ. You and I are difference makers where God has placed us, and we walk with Him. and we walk with him and each other as a team. God bless you this morning, my friends, as you live for him in that walk of faith. Amen. Father, we thank you for this time we've been able to spend in your word. We thank you for this fantastic book where Paul opens up his mind and his heart to us to show us the dynamics of his life, to show us his struggles, to show us his challenges, to show us his joy, but above all, to show us his victory in the Lord Jesus Christ. And we claim that victory this morning. Be with us, be with our families, be with our church family, both online and on campus, as we strive to walk with Jesus as we walk that life of faith. So bless us this morning. Father, watch over us. And Father, keep us in your gracious will. For we ask these mercies in the precious name, in the strong name of our Lord and Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, guys and gals, have a great week, and God bless you. Amen.